All right. Welcome. Good morning. Happy Easter morning at Mountain Movers Church. I'm a bit out of breath, but I'm glad you guys are here this morning joining us. Hey, listen, man, we have had an amazing time. Today marks the final round, round four of this series, The Greatest Comeback. How many of you have enjoyed this series? Yes. And also, this also marks the first of three of our new service times. How many of you guys are excited about that? Yes. So, hey, we're going to have a really, really, really good time. Okay, so if you're anything like me at all, I'm probably speaking to most of the guys in the room this morning. But, man, I love every Rocky film ever made, right? I don't know what it is. I mean, you know, he just... It's like in almost every one of the films, except for when Mr. T got him, right? He just got the tar beat out of him, like the entire fight. He just gets beat to this bloody pulp, right? And then just when you think he's down for the count, just when you think all hope is lost, what happens? Rocky gets up. Adrian! Adrian! Right? He can't see through all the beating of his eyes so puffy and full of blood. Adrian! Right? And he comes back. He is the comeback king of like all boxing movies, because they're like, I don't think there was any other boxing movies ever made, because once they made Rocky, you can't really make another boxing movie, right? But, you know, that's cool. That's cool. But it's a movie, right? It's not real. It's fake. We like movies. They're entertaining. But I like the real stuff too, right? I like the real stuff. And there's some real comeback kings in history. When you look back in fighting history, there's some real studs out there, all right? Some of you may be familiar. Back in 2010 in the world of ultimate fighting, these two guys by the name of Sonnen and Silva, you may remember this is arguably one of the greatest comebacks in UFC history. Sonnen, you know, he had just whipped three middleweight champs, and, you know, Silva's the reigning champ. He's the world champion, but you know, he trash-talks his way against Silva into a title fight, right? He earns his way into the ring by running his mouth, telling him and the whole world, I can beat him, I can take him. And, man, they duke it out, and I'm telling you, they get down to the last frame of the fight, and believe it or not, if you didn't see the fight, Sonnen was just kicking the daylights out of him the entire fight, just beating him to pieces. It was an awesome fight. Then at the end, now, but listen, because he's the underdog. We all like it when the underdog wins, right? I mean, you know, Silva had won the last 11 fights he had won as the reigning world champion. This guy's a stud, and we all want to see him get beat. And he's getting the tar kicked out of him. And just in the last round, all Sonnen has to do is just maintain this top position, right? And just stay on top of him and keep beating him. And all the, most of the ladies are saying, and you like this, why? It's cool. So he's beating the daylights out of him. And all he has to do is stay on top. And what happens? Silva slips in this triangular choke, right? This arm bar combination. And Sonnen taps out just within seconds, within like a minute of the fight left to go, to be totally over. He's gonna win the middleweight championship of the world, and he gets choked out, he taps out, and he ends in this horrible disaster, right? One of the greatest comebacks of all time. But, you know, for Silva, he was totally humbled that day. Man, it was a great comeback. Great, great comeback. And that's real. That's not Rocky. That's real stuff, right? How many of you guys remember 1990, Iron Mike Tyson versus Buster Douglas? How many of you guys remember that fight? Raise your hand. If you like boxing, this was an amazing, amazing fight, right? Because Tyson has, you know, basically over time, he's whipping everybody. Nobody can take him out. He hasn't even taken a fall in any of his fights, right? In his professional career, he hasn't even taken a fall. And then here comes Buster Douglas, and in the 10th round, right, he hits him and knocks him silly, and he's kind of shaking himself, and he gets a little dizzy. Then Buster Douglas comes in with a wham, 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 four hits. Iron Mike knocks his mouthpiece out. Iron Mike takes his mouthpiece and tries to put it in. He's stumbling around, puts it in one side of his mouth, then timber. Shoo, boom, and he hits the floor. And he tries to get up. He's stumbling around. He sits up for a second. He's like, my name is, I was born in, he cannot remember who he is or where he's from, and he tries to get up, and the ref calls the fight. Iron Mike lost, the underdog wins, we give it to Buster Douglas, the new heavyweight champion of the world, right? Awesome comeback, the underdog. Don't you guys like it when the underdog wins? Yes. These were great, great fights, these were great comebacks, but today, ladies and gentlemen, today we celebrate the greatest comeback of all time. We celebrate my King Jesus, the greatest comeback, and we celebrate today what he's done in our lives, and man, do I tell you what, he has completely just changed us from the inside out with what he did. But let's go back just a bit.
Now, you may be thinking to yourself, like, this is insane. What's with all the fighting lingo, especially if you're a girl? I had to, like, go back and study just for this series. Like, what is the UFC? Exactly. I read all the history. I read about all the fights. I found that fight right there, and I'm like, I can't even handle watching it because the dude's, like, getting pummeled and blood is, like, splattering. And I was going to show you guys
real blood.
Highlights
real
of blood. The best of the best of UFC, but blood is going everywhere. I was like, I cannot do that. They just ate donuts. Like, that's wrong. So we had to go back to Rocky, you know what I mean? Because it's just cool and inspiring. But you know, Easter is truly all about a comeback story. We don't think about it that way, but it really is. You know, when we go all the way back to round one, we talked about how this whole thing started with a fight in the Garden of Eden. When Satan picked a fight with humanity because God ultimately wanted one thing and Satan wanted to destroy it. Do you remember what that one thing is? God wanted relationship right there. God wanted relationship. Satan hated God. He wanted to break in. He wanted to break the bond between humanity and God. And so he weasels his way in. And yeah, he may have won that first round. And sin enters into the world. And sin, when it's full grown, the word of God says, brings forth death. And so he feels like he's on top now, that he has somehow conquered God, if you will. But yet God immediately begins to unfold this plan. And over the last few weeks, we've looked at that plan, but that plan began with God instituting this sacrificial system of sacrificing animals. Because the Bible says, and you can look with me in Leviticus chapter 17 and verse 11, it says that the life is in the blood. That life is in the blood. It is given. I can't even see that. I was trying real hard. It is given in exchange for a life that makes purification possible. I didn't think I'm old until my eyesight starts going, and then I stop making fun of all the people who have to do this, right? Because I become one of them.
It's
the fact
right,
of the matter
I'll
is...
I'll get you some new tennis balls for your walker.
Thank you.
It'll be all right.
That'd be awesome. The fact of the matter is, it's a life is in the blood. We talked about that. You take the blood out of anything, you take the life. And so what does God do? But he begins this system all the while knowing the date for the ultimate fight, which we're celebrating this weekend. God had planned it way back at the beginning, and he unfolds it over time. He chooses this guy named Abraham, and he says, hey, you're the one I'm going to send my son into the world through. Through your lineage, he's going to come. And so you see this story of Abraham begins to build this family. His family ends up in slavery in Egypt for how many years? Over 400 years in slavery when God does what? He comes in. They're the underdog. What does God do? But he completely annihilates the Egyptians, and he brings them out of the land of slavery. He brings them out, gives them what? Deliverance and new beginnings, because that's what God is all about. So then you come a little farther. Last week we talked about how Jesus came riding into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. He comes riding in, declaring, I'm the King of the Kings, but I'm not only the King of the Kings, I'm also the Passover Lamb. The little animals that you've sacrificed in the past, that's all going to come to an end when I lay down my own life for you. Last week we looked at how he was arrested, how he was tried, and ultimately crucified. But it didn't just end there. Today we're going to look at what the resurrection really means, how that comeback affects you and I today. Will you bow with me? Father God, we thank you, Lord Jesus, God, that today we have the opportunity to have a real and a life-changing relationship with you because of this one moment in history. God, I thank you that you loved us so much that you were willing to give, that you were willing, Jesus, to lay down your life and you were willing to overcome death, hell, and the grave. And today we stand before you a people that are humbled to be called your children, God, a people who are humbled because we know we're not worthy to receive anything that you give. God, we thank you. Father, anoint us today, Lord, as we deliver your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You know, we see Jesus expressing this purpose of why he came, and it was expressed through his life and through his death. He died that we might have life and have it more abundantly. And he showed us this with everything that he said, everything that he did. He expressed his love towards us and showed us continually over and over and over that he had one purpose, and that was to die for you and I, that we wouldn't have to die in our sins, but we could live in his grace and in eternity and make heaven our home. I want you to imagine for a second what it would have been like if you would have been one of those disciples that had traveled with Jesus for 3 years. They pretty much lived together, a band of brothers, traveling together. They ate together. They slept in the same place. They went fishing together. They went everywhere together as a group. Man, this was a tight, tight-knit bunch of guys, okay? And they were really, really, really close. And I want you to imagine now they've made their way into Jerusalem. Everything that Misty just said, they're witnessing all of this, and they really believe in their heart of hearts that Jesus is about to set up his kingdom in Jerusalem, and they're going to overthrow the Roman government. That's why they're saying, Christ, you know, when all this happens, who's going to stand at your right hand? Who's going to be at your left? They're thinking he's setting up his kingdom right here in Jerusalem. But then when they see all of these other things unfold, and, you know, they have the Last Supper. And remember, this whole time, he's throwing them a bone here and there. He's telling them, guys, in 3 days, right? This temple's going to be destroyed in 3 days. It's going to come up again, right? He's throwing them all these hints, all these clues of what he's about to do, and they don't get it. They're at the Last Supper, and he says, one of you guys is going to betray me, and I'm going to be like a lamb going to the slaughter, right? And they're hearing these things, but they're just kind of smiling through it, not getting it. They're thinking, okay, but you're going to set up your kingdom, right? That's all they hear, right? You're the King of Kings, right? And we're your crew, right? So they're excited and confused all at the same time. And as they see all of these events unfold, imagine what would be going through your mind, all right? You're in Jerusalem. There's thousands and thousands and thousands of people, and they're under the oppression of the Roman Empire. And now they've taken your master, Messiah, who you think is about to be king, into captivity. They try him, they begin flogging him, and now he's hanging on the cross, and now he's dead, and now he's in a tomb, and you're thinking, somewhere along the line, we missed it. Maybe he was just a prophet of God, and this is it, this is the end. And they're scared for their lives, because now all they can think about is, now we're next. Now they're going to come after us, and we're going to be the ones hanging on the cross, and we're going to be the ones in the tomb. But then something happens. There's a shift, and they, even though they experience it, they still don't really believe it until they see Jesus face to face. The fact that the stone was rolled away, and he overcame death, hell, and the grave. He comes back to life, looks it square in the face, death. And sin, the curse of sin, the greatest comeback of all time. And then this is what happens. You can read with us on the screen, if you will. Early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved. She said, they've taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him. Peter and the other disciples started out for the tomb. They were both running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He stooped and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter arrived and went inside. He also noticed the linen wrappings lying there, while the cloth that had covered Jesus' head was folded up and lying apart from the other wrappings. Then the disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For until then, they still hadn't understood the scriptures that said Jesus must rise from the dead. Then they went home. Verse 19 says this: that Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. Suddenly, Jesus was standing there among them. He says this: peace be with you. As he spoke, he showed them the wounds in his hands and in his side, and they were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. You can imagine at this moment, they're thinking, oh yeah. I mean, what an unbelievable ending to the longest fight of all time. King Jesus, Messiah, is murdered, thrown in the grave, and the power of death, the power of hell is demolished, and everlasting life, the power of God's presence, fills that body, bringing him back to life, and now he's standing in front of them, the greatest comeback king who's ever lived.
If you have your word, go to Revelation chapter 1. I love this verse. Verse 18, and it says this: I am the living one. I died, but look, I'm alive forever and ever. I hold the keys to death and the grave. Death couldn't stop Jesus. You know, when sin entered the world, death was the penalty that came upon us. But when Jesus went to the cross, it wasn't enough that he gave his life. You got to understand this, all right? So many times we look and we're like, it was the cross. You know what? The cross is where our sins are covered. But had he not rose from the dead 3 days later, none of us would have life today. Do you understand that? It's only because of the resurrection that death has been overcame. You see, sin's penalty was death. We not only were going to die physically now, because we were meant to live forever, but we were dying spiritually, separated, severed from God, no longer having that evening walk, no longer having the opportunity to just cry out to Jesus. You know, I think so often that we as a people today, we so don't get it. Because we, even people who don't know Jesus, in their time of need, will say the name of Jesus and realize there's power in the name of Jesus. But we have that all because Jesus overcame death, hell, and the grave. It couldn't hold him down. You know what? How does this apply to us? When you look at this story, I mean, it's history and it's awesome, but how does it apply to us? Here's what I want you to think about. How many times in your life do you need a comeback? How many times has life got you to the point where you feel like someone is on your neck and they are crushing you? Just 2 days ago, I talked with a lady at a convenience store, and she said, I just felt like I was under the water and somebody had their foot on my neck holding me under. A situation in her life had gripped her so to the point that she felt like there was nothing she could do. All hope was lost. And I said, hey, listen to me. There's always hope in Jesus. There is always hope. When you just surrender it to God, your circumstances may not turn out the way you want them to turn out. The disciples did not see the outcome they wanted. God did not have Jesus come to this earth to set up his earthly kingdom in Jerusalem. Those disciples did not rule and reign with him at that time. They couldn't see it, but listen to me, it was so much better. It was so much better. The Bible says in John 11:25 that he is the resurrection and the life, that anyone who believes in Christ, though he may die, will live eternally. You see, God didn't turn it around and say, now we get to live forever here on earth. He even made it better. He said, your physical bodies, they will still perish. But rather than you just dying separated from God, you now have the opportunity, because of the resurrection, because of the sacrifice that Jesus made, you have the opportunity to, when you close your eyes in death on this earth, to live and rule and reign with Jesus forever in heaven. That's where you can clap right there. Thank you.
Amen.
Listen to me. I don't have enough energy to like show you how I feel on the inside, because I every single day, Brett and I were in here at 5 o'clock this morning, tears running down our face, just thinking about what Jesus did for all of us. The only reason that we stand here today, people that are happy with smiles on our face, if you have Jesus, is because of this very moment in time. The church doesn't exist if it wasn't for the resurrection. We don't have the ability to have life if it wasn't for the resurrection. It's all because of this moment. The Bible says in Philippians 3:10, Paul said, I want to know Christ. What does it mean to know Christ? This word know is like a husband knows his wife. In an intimate, personal encounter, I want to know Jesus. I don't want to know about him. I don't want to hear facts about him. I want to know him. I want to know what he thinks. I want to feel his heartbeat because I want to be that close to him. I want to know Christ. I want to experience the same mighty power that raised him from the dead. Watch this.
Stand to your feet this morning if you are grateful. He is our comeback King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We have so many things to be thankful for this morning, guys. So many things. Guys, I shared this with our volunteers this morning. I want to share it really quick. There was this guy on the radio that I was listening to yesterday, and he was a pilot. He had had a plane crash, and he died, and he went to heaven. And the Lord allowed him to come back and share the experience that he had had while in heaven. And as he began to share his experience there, which I'll tell you, by the way, I've heard multiple people that have said they've gone to heaven, and all their stories line up perfectly. Some of the same exact things that they say they see and that are not in the Bible match up perfectly. And what was so amazing is as he began to share his story, he just began to weep. He began to cry. And he said, if there's one thing I can say about heaven, he said, it's gratitude. It's gratitude. It's everybody that's there realizes that there's nothing that they ever did that caused them to deserve to be there in heaven. Everybody realizes the death, the sacrifice that Jesus paid for us all when none of us qualified to have life. To have heaven as our home. It's only because he invited us by his gift of free grace, eternal life, because of him covering our sins with his blood, are we made worthy. And he said everybody there realizes every second they operate in thanksgiving because they know they don't belong there, but they've been invited to be there because of who he is. Guys, Jesus went to the grave for you. He went to the grave for me. And when in life's toughest moments, when you feel like you're down for the count, when you feel like you are getting beaten to a bloody pulp, not just physically, but spiritually and emotionally and relationally, maybe in your career, your finances, maybe it has something to do with your kids, you just feel like you are getting so hammered. I want to tell you that the same power that brought Jesus back from the grave is available and accessible in your life for you to have the same comeback. Galatians 2 and 20 says, we are crucified with Christ. And it's not us who lives, but it's Christ who lives inside of us. He gave himself for us willingly. It's not by the flesh that we live, but it's by the faith that we have in the Son of Man who gave himself up for us. So the same power that brought him back is alive and well inside of you and I. You just have to tap into it. How many of you guys need some comeback power in your life? Can I see your hands? I want to pray with you right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray that you would just invade these circumstances. We call upon the power of the cross, the resurrection power that brought him back. We call upon the most wonderful, most beautiful name above all names. That is the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. There is no greater name than this one. In heaven or on earth, his name is powerful. His name is mercy. His name is healing. His name is grace. His name is wonderful. He is Hosanna the Savior, everlasting Father, almighty God, wonderful counselor, Prince of Peace, Emmanuel, King of Kings, God with us. We call upon that power. We call upon that name right now, God. Give every person this place that needs a comeback by the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I want to remind you of the one reason God did this entire thing. He did it because he wanted a real relationship with you.
Yes.
He wanted to talk to you. God Almighty, the creator of the universe, cares to have a friendship with you and with me. That scripture says, I was crucified with Christ. And what that means is, in order to have a real relationship with Jesus, you have to be willing to lay down your own life. You have to be willing to lay down your own dreams and your own desires. And you've got to be willing to take up that cross. You got to be willing to say, God, whatever you want for my life, that's what I want.
Thank you, Father.
But you know the awesome thing with that is that God created you. He's the inventor. He's the one who thought up the idea of humanity. He formed you in your mother's womb. He breathed life into your lungs. And he said, I have a plan and a purpose and a destiny for your life. The problem is, until we come into alignment in a real relationship with God, we will never fulfill why we were placed on this planet. And we will never be truly happy. We will never truly feel complete and fulfilled. Today, I want to tell you that Jesus laid down his life. He took the penalty for your sin and mine when he stretched his arms out and bowed his head in death. His blood was drained from his body so that we could have life. And he rose from the dead so you could live forever in heaven. You can know that when you bow your head in death, that you will live forever in his presence. If that's you today and you say, I want that. I want a real relationship. I don't want to just know about God. I want to know God. I want that same power that raised Christ from the dead to be on the inside of me. I want to be an overcomer. I want to stop allowing life to beat me down and beat me up. I don't want my emotions to control me, but I want a real relationship full of power. If that's you, I want to tell you today that it's a free gift, and all you need to do is pray a very simple prayer that we're going to lead you in right now. If that's you, you want that kind of a relationship, I'm going to count to three. I just want you to throw your hands in the air. No one else is looking, just your pastors. We want to know who we're praying for. If that's you, will you raise your hand? I want a real relationship with Jesus on the count of three. One, two, three. Amen. I see your hands. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. It's exactly what God wants, man. He just wants people to come back. He wants to reconcile that relationship, like long lost brothers who have completely severed that relationship. That's what sin did. But right now, it's reconciled as you pray this prayer. Will you pray it with me? Everyone together, Father God.
Father God.
We love you.
We love you.
We thank you for the sacrifice.
Thank you for the sacrifice
that you gave for us.
You gave for us.
Jesus, we ask that you would come into our heart.
Jesus, we ask that you would come into our heart.
You would forgive us of our sins.
You would forgive us of our sins.
Give us new life.
Give us new life.
Give us a real relationship with you.
Give us a real relationship with you.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Will you just give a hand to those who just made the best decision of their life?
Hey, thanks for joining us today. We sincerely hope the message impacted your life. Stay connected with us by following us online, or you can find us on Facebook. If you would like to partner with us financially, we have a few easy ways to give. You can text your giving to 77977 and simply type in MMC and follow the prompts. Or you could find us online at www.mountainmoverschurch.org and click the Give Now tab. Or you could simply mail your giving in to 24000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. We are a church leading people into a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ that is contagious. We look forward to seeing you next week.